Hello, it's my tremendous honor to be invited to give the 19th annual Hellenic lecture at the Hellenic Institute of Royal Holloway. I'm tremendously grateful for the wonderful introduction of Professor Ken Badcock, and also thank my colleagues Chara Lambos Gendrinos, Baris Papamichos Granakis, and Achilleas Chatzikyriakou, with whom it has been a pleasure to collaborate. Today, then, I want to tell you more by way of a slide presentation about the multiple anniversaries and their legacies of 1821. That means 1871, 1921, 1930 actually, and 1971. I'll do that by way of about a dozen slides. So, since the outbreak of the Greek War of Independence in 1821, the Greek people have celebrated three major anniversaries, the 50th, the 100th, and 150th anniversary date of the inception of this revolutionary war that led to sovereign statehood after nearly four centuries of Ottoman rule. These three jubilees, each with their own legacies, have come to represent three different ways of celebrating Greek statehood that have nonetheless quite a lot in common. The celebrants consider the festivities to be in the best interest of the Greek state, and its younger generation especially. But many ceremonies and subsequent state rituals display the more self-serving political culture or nationalist ideology. Through 1971, Greek political and religious nationalisms, plural, represented two sides of one coin, and they tended to reinforce each other through historicizing parades and other displays of unbroken cultural, if not religious, continuity. They posited a linear and authentic progression from Greek antiquity through post-classical Byzantine and post-Byzantine times. Thus, the celebrations and reenactments, with their commemorative events and symbolic images, acquired a prescriptive, a normative character which further advanced their aim to educate youth in state-promoted nationalism. In anticipation of the bicentennial of Greece's independence, it may prove helpful then to study these earlier celebrations, their main theme and agendas, and the imaginary nation to which they appealed, and some of the images and symbols and reports that they have left behind. We expect to find the years 1871, 1921, and 1971 as key anniversary dates, but we are immediately struck by an important exception. The grand celebrations of the centenary of 1921 were postponed due to political and military circumstances. Besides, the Greeks look forward with great anticipation to a more wide-ranging series of events that was scheduled for 1930, the centenary of the year in which the Greek state was formed. Thus, the past and present, and even the unknown but projected future, affected the making of the anniversaries of Greece as a product of a revolution and as a nation. Also, the various anniversaries offer up a potent reminder that on each occasion, the nation's process of becoming was yet to be completed. The year 1971, preceded by a few turbulent decades, the Balkan Wars and the ensuing territorial gains. The crisis of 1921-1922 signaled a reduction in the Greek territorial expanse and an even greater blow to Greek political and cultural self-confidence. The year 1971, which fell about halfway through the dictatorship period of 67-74, was used by the military regime to affirm revolution and independence, in inverted commas, but by the opposition to interrogate the sovereign and democratic nature of the long-suffering state. The question now remains what the anniversary of 2021 holds in store, even if it holds in store a delay. For a nation that has seen dozens of years of a crisis economy, several natural disasters, and of course is afflicted, just like everybody else, by the current COVID crisis. But let us start with the first celebration, 1871. 50 years. The celebration of 1871, since the Greek Revolution, was much anticipated. A few events raised the stakes in the lead-up to the anniversary year. Russia had been all holding on to the relics of ecumenical patriarch Gregory V, who was the leader of the Orthodox Greek religious minority living under the Ottoman Empire, had been killed shortly after the outbreak of the Greek Revolt. The Ottoman Porte retaliated against traitors, in inverted commas, among the Greek aristocrats who served in prized clerical and administrative positions. It considered the then patriarch, despite his own calls for caution and even for submission, to be one of those traitors. Upon his assassination, Patriarch Gregory's remains had been taken to Odessa, and half a century later, the Greek state arranged to bring these relics home to the new nation. To the new nation, and then to also planned also to rebury them with due pomp and circumstance. And they planned to do so in the Metropolitan Cathedral of Athens. The conspicuous involvement of the royal pair, King George I and Queen Olga, marked the interment as a nationalist and Athenocentric occasion. The Greek state also arranged to have the patriarch's honorific statue erected in front of the main official building, the Propylaea, of the University of Athens, and you see it here in the slides. The statue was sculpted by Georgios Vitalis, but was unveiled with a slight delay, the delays being part of the anniversaries as well. As a religious symbol, the statue joined that of another ethnomonarch of the Greek Revolution, Rigas Velestinis or Rigas Phereos, who found this place at the other side of the university building. This tribute then to the precursor champion of the revolutionary struggle was the work of sculptor Ioannis Kossos, who acknowledged Rigas's enlightened and secular political philosophy and also the post-revolutionary idealization of his person and aspirations. Historian Tom Halland has characterized the ideology behind the 1871 Jubilee ceremony and the erection of the statues as the ultimate wedding of orthodoxy to the revolution. Significantly, too, the plan to create two statues of revolutionary martyrs superseded an earlier proposal, interestingly enough, about erecting statues of ancient deities. The two statues then tied the revolution to new institutions of the modern nationalist Greek state, in particular to the very University of Athens before which they figure, with its own classicizing ethos. Both statues were executed in a rather conventional style, which did not assert any new aesthetic, but affirmed rather an existing code of classicizing. One had to wait until 1875, then, for the statue of Adamantios Korais to be added again in front of the former building of the University of Athens. Of course, we know Korais well. He left a rich intellectual legacy to the new Greek state. He made his permanent home in Paris, where he shared in the French Enlightenment theory and in radical thought. He laid the foundations of a Hellenic library of editions of seminal classical texts with which to instruct the younger Greek generations. This Hellenic library functioned as a secular vehicle for transmitting Western cultural ideas, which inculcated in the Greek reading public an awareness of one of its most valued possessions, remnants from antiquity. The concern for the younger Greeks' education was a recurrent theme also in the subsequent anniversary celebrations, whose pageantry was modeled after French revolutionary prototypes. All of these initiatives exemplified the deliberate creation of new cultural and social beings in young male Greeks who would cultivate patriotism. They became identified with the nationalist didactic ideology of Korais as the revolutionary Greek expatriate who went on to inspire many others. Subsequent anniversaries use Greek texts and monuments alike, appeal to symbolic imagery and again to a normative ideology, strengthened by a classicizing ethos that the three statues of 1871 in its expanded scope had first come to embody. But Universal celebrations remain more limited in scope than, for instance, the broader 19th century Greek impulse to organize knowledge and nationalism. Knowledge about and power over the ancients and their artifacts began to overlap with the creation of national museums, printed collections, libraries, theater stages, and the educational infrastructure of the modern Greek state at large. And I want to turn back for a moment to my first slide of Rigas and Korais helping Greece on her feet as they are surrounded by the very symbols of Greek antiquity, with a phoenix rising from his ashes, symbolic of the resurrection of the Greek state, but a phoenix that we will see in various incarnations throughout this presentation. The three statues then of Rigas Phereos, Patriarch Gregory, and Korais, now in their chronological order of their making, embodied the fusion of antiquity, Byzantium, and the modern era. They captured the power of religion to augment nation building and vice versa, as well as the potential of language and patrimony. Taken together and with the University of Athens as their backdrop and urban scape, the statues showed the Greeks' commitment to the blending of all of these facets of the modern Greek nation. Thus, the 1871 anniversary celebration signaled an early call of achieved success, even though a major struggle of religious integration, territorial expansion and defeat, linguistic debate and reform, and overall institutional restructuring still lay ahead. The seminal model then of Greek historical continuity underpinned the 5-volume history of the Hellenic nation, here visible and also existing in future editions, that influential nation-building work of Konstantinos Paparigopoulos. Paparigopoulos had proposed 5 eras of Hellenism with which to build continuity. The epochs of ancient Macedonian, Christian medieval, and modern Hellenism. But this work has been remembered in 3 eras, ancient Byzantine and modern Hellenism. These 3 ages of Hellenic civilization congealed in a form of teleology for the Greek state, which underpinned its irredentist and Byzantine ambition of the great idea, the Megali Idea. They became staples of nearly all nationalist celebrations and their visual and verbal rhetoric. Decades prior to 1871, rewinding the clock here for a moment, the initiative had been raised to stage Greek history as a continuum of male athletic prowess inherited from antiquity, and that would strengthen national reawakening in a particular specific manner. In January of 1835, Ioannis Koletis, Minister of Internal Affairs to King Otto, published in French a plan for athletic games and festivals to commemorate at public expense the major events and battle sites of the 1821 War of Independence, and also the spirit of national unification that its advocates had propounded. Significantly, the celebrations of the 25th of March as the anniversary date of the Greek Revolution, coinciding with the Christian feast of the Annunciation of the Virgin Mary, was established in 1838, or 3 years after Koletis had issued his plan. The events proposed by Koletis were modeled after the Panhellenic athletic games of antiquity and other festivals of antiquity, such as the famous Olympian, Pythian, Nemean, and Isthmian athletic games, but also the classical religious festivals of the Panathenaia, the Eleusinia, the Thesmophoria, the Great Dionysia, and so on. Koletis singled out the particular advantages of such pageants, and pageants will start to loom large for the newborn Greek state. The international resonance of such festivals and their role in strengthening the royal house, or whichever government was in place, and the tremendous ethical benefits, according to him. He says it in French, dimanche avantage moral. And they would deliver, and they promised to bring modern Greece closer to ancient Greece. Koletis summed up Let us try to make the modern Greek approach the ancient Greek, to make the son reproduce the father in genealogical language that we will see reappear. The vision then of Colette is to recreate almost physically aspects of the athletic competitions and religious feasts that took place in antiquity was instrumental in designing the state-sponsored pageantry of Greece in the 20th century, including its anniversary spectacles. The ideal of bestowing a renaissance on the Greek nation through ancient sports and their ethos drove, of course, the 19th century Zappas Olympics. However, the 1896 revival of the Olympic Games proved to be the most important catalyst in the process of establishing the Greek heroic pageantry of athletic and cultural continuity. Through the pre-World War I era, Greece was eager to claim and secure its guardianship, its ownership of the authentic ancient athletic tradition, which would become more significant as the modern Olympic movement gained wider local and Western support. Historicizing pageantry tied to symbolic dates and locations, such as the Panathenaic Stadium in Athens, which has ancient foundations, drew from the Enlightenment philosophy and the praxis of the French Revolution, which espoused the edifying value of mass public spectacles, dynamic bodies moving through dramatic spaces, ancient or ancient style monuments, and the arts. In Greece, however, the heroic pageantry of continuity and syncretism acquired a life all its own and determined nearly all subsequent types of historical reenactments in the nationalist vein. And I want to dwell here for a moment on the engraving that puts the date of 1776 of the first ancient Olympics next to 1896 of the first modern Olympics, that puts French and French language next to the Panathenaic Stadium and the Olympiaion in the background. A whole lot of symbols and messages captured in just one image. On to the 100th anniversary, the centenary. The aftermath of World War I and Greece's own political and military predicament prevented the year 1921 from being the celebratory centenary that it could have been. The Cretan statesman Eleftherios Venizelos was dominating the national and even the international scene. For some, he gave all to the fight against Greek oligarchy and monarchy of the early years of the 20th century. Leader of a prolonged struggle against the royalist elite, Venizelos' star shone bright through 1920, but it wasn't meant to last. As Prime Minister of Greece, Venizelos traveled to Paris in 1919 to represent his country at the Paris Peace Conference. There he secured Allied consent for Greece to occupy the region of Smyrna and its hinterland in Asia Minor. Venizelos then pursued the signing of the Treaty of Sèvres in August 1920, which postulated settlement terms between Greece and the Ottoman Empire and sanctioned the Greek occupation of Asia Minor. Thus he became the executor of Greece's irredentist aspirations of the great idea. At the peak of his power, Venizelos was proclaimed the architect of Greater Greece, or the Greece of two continents and the five seas. In mid-September of 1920, he staged his partisan patriotic victory celebrations at the Panathenaic Stadium, that is the old Olympic Stadium, or today known as the Kali Marmara in downtown Athens. Venizelos' own triumphal procession, if you want, provoked reactions that ranged from uncritical adulation to shock and outcry. Let's say that they sent some ominous signals. Venizelos did not shy away from self-promotion and the relentless quest for patriotic prestige. After he lost the November 1920 elections, however, he went into self-imposed exile and temporarily disappeared from the Greek political scene. By the 25th of March 1921, the Greek army had suffered the first military setbacks in the battle against the new Turkish nationalist forces. The sense of danger of loss and catastrophe would soon be borne out by the Smyrna disaster of mid-September 1922. The post-1922 era may have been ripe for a reconsideration of the irredentist great idea, but in March of 1921, the time to rethink the propagandistic use of mass pageantry had not yet come. Did 1921 as a jubilee date then go by unnoticed because of the shadows cast over it by the current events? Not at all. The year 1921 saw modest ceremonies that again placed the emphasis on honoring the revolutionary martyrs. As Dora Marcato has noted, Spiridon Lambros spearheaded the centenary commemorating the War of Independence. He envisioned festivals that would be supervised by academics mainly, historians, archaeologists, and also folklorists. The 1921 celebrations would offer up a modest blend of historical reenactments, and they prompted the erection of war memorials and the foundation or restoration of monuments and other prestigious public venues, such as, for instance, the Herodes Atticus Theater. Venizelos himself saw in the muted 1921 anniversary a means to again bolster his political and military project of a Greater Greece, a quest to consolidate Greek territories in Asia Minor, to annex new worlds, and to recapture Constantinople. This backdrop transformed the 1921 parade into a Venizelist rally, not unlike his notorious triumphal procession of mid-September 1920. Thus, Venizelos tapped a powerful wellspring of personal prestige and party political propaganda, and he tied the performative quality of military expeditions and parades to the spectacle of official representation. Both codified patriotism and institutionalized nationalism in his own conception. Classicizing festival pageantry was mined for its political capital, as well as for its cultural capital, to use notions established by Pierre Bourdieu. The Venizelos production, then, of the leader's personal triumph marked the public euphoria about the Greeks' military, territorial, and diplomatic gains. But on March 25th, 1921, it was too early to claim victory in the Asia Minor campaign. At Venizelos' instigation, the Greeks had ambitiously occupied Smyrna and its hinterland for many months, during which Turkish ratification of this and other Greek territorial expansion into Asia Minor had not been forthcoming. The Turkish victory, the Greek rout, and the Smyrna disaster of September 1922 meant that the history of 1821 was being reversed, that the centenary of 1921 was completely unraveling. Venizelos' grand scheme and the entire vision of the great idea collapsed in the ashes of Smyrna. The dream of the grand celebration of the greater Greece, of the final realization of the great idea, was forever crushed. Critics of the Anatolian adventure had feared the Greek overreach all along. Once the battle sites were no longer those of historical defense, but had become those of military hubris, the scars of defeat were harder to explain and certainly took much longer to heal. The surviving ethnic Greek populations of Asia Minor were forced to leave for an uncertain future in Greece, which, as a country then with very limited resources or infrastructure, had already been straining under the burden of prolonged war. It took Greece, at least through the interwar years, to properly recover. Venizelos strategically blamed King Constantine I and a group of military commanders for the Smyrna disaster of 1922. But Venizelos himself had risked Greek territorial integrity and political sovereignty in the historical gamble of the Asia Minor campaign. The consequences were deeply divisive politically and affected culture and commemoration as well, not surprisingly. In another act of overreach, then, the Greeks postponed the big celebrations of their country's centenary to commence on the symbolic date of the 25th of March of the year 1930. The delay of the centenary festivities was motivated by the once again unrealistic expectation of new games to be celebrated by 1930. This new centennial would celebrate the actual formation and recognition of the independent Greek state, which was founded in 1830. But when the grand centennial of 1930 finally came around, the atmosphere was still subdued in and around Athens. Again, Athens was the geographical center point of the festivities. Venizelos' last administration of 1928 through 1932, proclaimed as the Great 4 Years, the Megali Tetraetia, oversaw the celebrations, which explains their self-congratulatory tone and ethos. Once more, politics, the military, religion, and ideology blended together in mass spectacles of the state staging itself. Lambros was present again and inspired the celebrations, which reaffirmed the idea and the ideal of national continuity and the medium of outdoor mass festivals, emboldened by the contemporary moral and didactic ideology. As in 1921, an organizing committee in which academics and archaeologists especially assumed key positions, designed and scheduled the events, 1 month full of events. In addition to historicizing parades, these events included the ceremonial raising of the flag, the firing of cannons, ample occasions for speech making, the launching of publications, and also religious services. Notably, the centennial also recreated the Panathenaic procession in a classicizing and nationalist spirit. Athena's new peplos, that garment of antiquity, however, was substituted by the Greek flag, which, according to plan, would be changed annually on top of the Acropolis, and each year a Greek city, a different Greek city or region, would be responsible for the symbolic flag ceremony. Thus, classicizing public spectacle merged with the modern Greek demand for regional as well as national unification. The tomb of the unknown soldier on Syndagma Square, here visible on the left, was begun in 1929, and it was meant to deliver yet another symbolic message of moral strength and continuity. But delays played the role again. Unfortunately, it was not ready to be unveiled in time. In fact, it took until the 25th of March, 1932. It missed the centenary of 1930 by 2 years. But the completion of the restoration works on the Acropolis was included in the formal centenary program as well. In 1930, Venizelos rededicated the bronze statue of the Revolutionary War hero Kolokotronis, whom you see on the right. Kolokotronis was imprisoned by King Otto, of course, and thus Venizelos could place himself in a popular genealogy of revolutionary heroes, a genealogy that was anti-royalist as well as revolutionary. As in 1921, the 1930 centennial celebrations of Greek statehood raised reservations about Venizelos hailing his personal return to politics, especially given that 1921 and 1922 were still very recent and very traumatic in people's memory. Also, the prominence of Cretan culture was pervasive, given that the prime minister was from Crete. Venizelos drew extensively from the structure and the aesthetics of the mass events organized at the time by the Lyceum of Greek Women, or Lycio Elenido, held, guess what, at the Panathenaic Stadium. It was the Lyceum that had first added the Minoan age to the parade of the canonical 3 eras of Greek history. In the great national festival of 1926 at the Panathenaic Stadium, those Minoan ages, those Minoan representations and reenactments have been part of the spectacles. The staged representation of the bloodless sacrifice from the Minoan period was a creation of the Lyceum. In 1930, it was again the Lyceum that brought the parade of heroes and heroines of the Greek War of Independence to the Panathenaic Stadium, and we'll see more of those. Significantly, the embodied display of the now 4 eras in the life of the Greek nation No, including the Minoan age, that is, became part of subsequent mass events. Thus, the War of Independence and the formation of the Greek nation were symbolically linked to Byzantium, Greek antiquity, and to Crete. The past had to infuse the present in an unbroken continuum of patriotic spirit and resiliency. The latter, the message of the indomitable spirit of the Greek people and its fighters, and thus of the Greekness of the centenary, was both prominent and poignant, given the recent collapse of the irredentist dream and the ensuing mass refugee problem. It's an interesting image here below to see the ancient agora with the temple, with the Hephaestus, known as the Tision, in the backdrop, and refugee tents of 1922 in the foreground. An ancient and a very poignant contrast between ancient and current. The hyperbolic Greek festival pageantry held at the Panathenaic Stadium, of course, predated that of the dictatorship of General Ioannis Metaxas, with whose regime we actually often associated. But I'm here to say that it is older than that. I want to dwell for a moment on a commemorative medal. Apparently, there's quite a fashion going on for commemorative medals. And here is the phoenix again rising from his ashes on one side, and then on the other side of the medal, the dates of Greece's territorial expansion. The medal was struck for this anniversary of 1930. The territorial expansions are obvious. They start with the annexation of the Ionian Islands, ceded by Britain in 1864, and then the Northern Territories, Thessaly, 1881, Macedonia, 1913, and Eastern Thrace, 1919. The medal suggests a strong link between the War of Independence and the more recent wars. It effectively places those recent wars in a genealogy of patriotic struggle and territorial expansion on behalf of the nation, in a linear narrative of unquestioned continuity and destiny. Mementos like this token helped to disseminate the message of territorial unification and cultural homogenization. Skipping forward 50 years in time now, 1971, the self-celebration of the military regime. Metaxas, as I said, or the colonels of the dictatorship of 67-74, did not invent their parade festivals and athletic contests, of which they did many, but they certainly made them their own by expanding and militarizing them. The architects of the latter regime's events have before them a series of by now canonical templates and a performative repertoire from which to choose in accordance with prevailing state priorities. The strongmen of the coup of the 21st of April 1967 had certain technical advantages working for them as well, cinema being one of them. Thus, Yorgos Papadopoulos propped up his public celebrations with suitable, censored television and cinema work and other media coverage, whose road praise was at times the illusionary equivalent of the road applause of the big events, the theamata, the grand spectacles, again in the Panathenaic Stadium. By 1971, the year of the now 150th jubilee of the Greek Revolution, the dictators had sought and found an authentic tradition of origins and a valid, quotation marks again, genealogy for their own revolutionary intervention, their self-styled regenerative revolution. Thus, the cult of the revolutionary past came to serve a cult of much advertised new but undemocratic beginnings. The revolution of 21 April 67 was far removed from the kind of liberalizing socio-political reform that Greece badly needed. The colonels also posited the anniversary date of their own takeover as a new national holiday. Papadopoulos' casting, then, of the revolution of 1821 as some sort of grand analog for his own military aggression smacked of propagandistic distortion. The 150th anniversary of the revolution and the anticipated nationwide festivities were announced with a similar humoristic degree of fanfare. The Jubilee-specific events were planned at a large meeting held in the Old Parliament in September of 1970. Papadopoulos himself gave the directions. The top officials of the political and ecclesiastical hierarchy participated as well. The attendees decided that the celebration should last all through 1971, which was named as the year of the Hellenic national freedom. The organizers also shared an important concern to add a series of new events, but many were so hyperbolic as to become real caricatures. For the dictators, the theatrical communication through displays of military culture was one of tradition, supremacy, and proven authenticity. The junta relentlessly promoted the values of the country's rulers, ancestors, and roots by grounding them in a proud, authentic, quotation marks, history, in an unchanging geocultural territory, again very ethnocentric, and in unshaken diachronic time. Moreover, the dictators presented the battles against interior and exterior communists of the past and present alike as interrelated parts of a single holy war in defense of the nation. Their official rhetoric, bolstered by the protected state of martial law, was rife with calls for patriotic loyalty to the nation's protectors and for vigilance and superstition of other Greeks. Thus, the 1970 Jubilee and also other junta festivals emptied out or disappeared the past of the Civil War, especially, and the leftist sympathies and forces of resistance that lived on. Not surprisingly, the official rhetoric of ethnic pride and of the strong national Greek family appealed to the patriotic sentiment of those Greeks who sought stability, especially after many years of military and political turmoil. For some, the regime's stagings then of historical continuity were gratifying precisely because they were long familiar. Plenty of others, however, realized that the junta was reducing Greek valor to purebred military character, and even then more to muscle power than to military genius. More outspoken critics saw a rather farcical spectacle and a transparent concoction of propaganda. Here you see the Phoenix rising from his ashes with the military man of the 21st of April in a direct pathway, in a direct genealogical lineage, if you want, that leads back to Eleftheria Epanatos of 1821, but with a stretch all the way to the Persian Wars and the famous Molon Lave over the other known quotations or battle cries of victorious conquests of Greek history. Obviously, the monumental junta festivals did not come about without the planning and cooperation of many more people in other realms of cultural production as well. James Paris, a Greek-American entrepreneur, became the colonel's favorite producer of patriotic films, to which the armed forces readily contributed. Paris's morale-boosting war epics, going back to some of these film images here, did their part to support the dictator's revolution, and like the festivals, they featured the typical purple passages of Greek history and also stories of personal sacrifice for the good of the collective. The genre generated movies such as The Souliots of 1972 and of course Papadopoulos's Hero of the Greek Revolution from 1971, the year of the anniversary, directed by Erikos Andreou, perhaps the genre's best known film. I wish I could dwell more on cinema of this era, but this is just to whet your appetite. If you would like to learn more, join us on May the 28th when the Society for Modern Greek Studies has a special event dedicated to cinema of the revolutionary years. I just want to dwell for a moment to the antipode of heroic filmmaking. Here is Jenny Carresi through the voice of Aristophanes Lysistrata making fun of the heroes of the revolution, the helmets of the heroes of the revolution, and of course the language of the dictators and ministerial parties. The regime's exaggerated displays of military prowess at the 1971 Jubilee and on many other occasions were meant to reshape the people's knowledge of Greek history and to inspire their pride for being racial descendants of the ancient Greeks. Thus, the junta festivals picked up where the practice of school history lessons and their nationalizing mission had left off, teaching sacrifice-oriented patriotism and conformism in the name of Greek continuity. From the 19th and well into the 20th century, instruction in Greek history in primary and secondary schools, preferably highly structured, highly disciplined, was marked and marred by its relentless emphasis on the patriotic national past. Ancient Greek language and literature, too, were often taught in tedious, ethnocentric ways, presenting the symbols of classical culture as sacred cows. For decades, patriotism had been performed in Greek schools' teachings, in the teachers' lecturing, and in the students' regurgitating of historical content that was to be idealized, re-idealized, but never reinterpreted. The junta festivals joined traditional pedagogy in using youth and adults as a prime material, almost as a raw material, for nationalist subject formation. To be sure, the nationalization of the masses through formal history lessons, as through festivals that display the nation's bodily performance or that invent national traditions, is a widely shared process in constructing modern nation states, not just the Greek one. However, the Greek dictators' manipulation of the past was certainly an extreme case in the long course of the state's appropriation of national history. Among the sharpest detractors of the regime's spectacles were students and youth, who mocked all officialdom, its bombast, its victory festivals, and military parades. They resented the artificial cultivation of sound morality. Here's the moral again. Especially Greek history's heroes appearing as exemplar virtutes in a cardboard morality play, out of touch with the progressive spirit and the changing mores of the late 1960s. The spectacle of 1971-2 instilled a rigid essentialism which proved far removed from the fluidity of the Greek history of 1821. The 1970 Jubilee was a commemoration of the past, but it was also some sort of a hypocritical legitimation of an undemocratic present. Its events did not leave any notable artistic or architectural legacies. For a short while, it looked like the dictators would implement the building of the nation's vow, but when we look at the plans, the architectural plans today, in retrospect, we are quite lucky that the plans did materialize. The junta festivals then only affirmed past and outdated commemorative modes. The anniversary was detached from contemporary cultural developments as audiences and creators failed to look to a new era. Ever since the collapse of the dictatorship, the critiques of the misuse of history that began with the colonels, but that built on older traditions, has been very vocal. Critics have rallied against the historicizing and the anti-communist pageantry, especially, which lasted through the early 1980s. Today, Greek parades and celebrations may well be perceived as more contemporary, but they still contain much antiquated material and rhetoric. And I was kind of struck by the fact that the commemorative medals are back, and even though there is no image of a phoenix, there's certainly the word of the phoenix, and there is a going back to the mention of the drachma as well, and the ever-present Olympic laurel wreath. These are some of the commemorative medals of 2021. But I resort to some cartoon predictions. The figure on the right shows a cartoon drawn by the popular Kostas Mitropoulos, and actually dating to the 14th of November 1999. Mitropoulos' character of your average Greek is somewhat perplexed as he makes the round of Greece's history and its heroic chronology. The date of 1821 stands out in bold lettering. Yet this innocent man, ready to dedicate his own wreath of honor to the Greek heroes, cannot but sense that he's walking away from the future, or worse, that he's going around in circles and missing out on a real future. The cartoon on the left, then, is by the famous Kier on the reflection of an anniversary of the Politecnio, but giving an expression to what we could call a fiesta fatigue. In conclusion, then, the productive but also troubled realm of Greek historical celebrations and of mass pageants has, for decades now, been central to the formation of Greek identity. For the greater purpose of instilling national sensibilities, the Greek state has put itself on display on the occasion of landmark anniversaries. Historiae hi prosopo, as is shown on prominent avenues in Athens. The performative dimensions of anniversary parades, with their typical sequences of heroic episodes through the canonical ages of Hellenic civilization, had to model proper ideals and modes of conduct for Greece's younger people, especially. Three major events have marked the nation's celebration history of the outbreak of the Greek War of Independence in 1821. The domestic political culture and ideology of the three major anniversary dates could hardly have been more different. Nonetheless, the execution as well as the objective of these jubilees of the past converged as they resorted to classicizing statues and mass pageantry to mark the Greek state's public and formal use of history. Surveying these anniversaries has proven to be a fruitful exercise in anticipation of a critical evaluation of the bicentenary of the year 2021. Now, lots of critical voices have gone up in the run-up to the year 2021, and especially to the symbolic date of the 25th of March 2021. Around this time last year, when the COVID crisis first necessitated the first drastic action, and everybody feared that hospitals would soon be unable to cope, three prominent Greek historians publicly called for not spending money on national parades, but for bolstering the ailing Greek health sector. And I think their call has been heard, even though somewhat belatedly. Their argument was shared by a lot of other Greeks as well, as this slide may make abundantly clear. It juxtaposes famous paintings related to episodes of the Greek Revolutionary War with the real crisis and the real battle going on in 2020-2021. The Greeks of the three anniversaries of the revolution have not yet reached a consensus about how to present recent Greek history, but many had come to realize that the true interest of the national past lay in how it constituted and conditioned the future. Their monuments and festivals served the national interest and also the goal of political cohesion. They projected the idea of progress along historical and cultural continuum, and they posted the survival, revival, and even resurrection of Greek patriotic ethos. The sustained continuity model that linked the past to the present was undoubtedly engaged in a certain amount of national myth-making. Also, this model kept suggesting a paradoxical kind of parthenogenesis of Greek culture, as if Greek culture moved forward in a controlled unilateral vacuum from one military conquest to the next, and was only ever driven by male leaders. The last jubilee of 1971 in particular, marked an intense era in Greek politics and culture, when truth, authority, Greek history, destiny, and collective identity were the subjects of public standoffs that played out in the old venues, not unlike a few episodes going on today. Perhaps for the last time, this jubilee tried to solidify a national master narrative that reasserted the political and socio-economic status quo. In hindsight, however, it failed to once more crystallize the national myth. Let us hope that the bicentennial celebrations of 2021 then will build on a critical reception of the past jubilees and will prove to be meaningfully different. Thank you.